I want to start with your background, your family background. Many musicians, at least traditionally, were groomed in families with musical connections or extensive musical background. Can you describe something about your family and its connection to music?
As far as my family was concerned, in my immediate family, there was no musicians. My father was very fond of music. And in those days, we had that huge, big radio, Fairbanks Morse or whatever it was called. And he would listen only to Hindustani classical music whenever it was broadcast on the radio. And that was some of the music I was exposed to. My mother says that she grew up in Tamil Nadu and Andhra. So in those areas, there was a custom that every day or every other day, a music teacher would come to the house and teach all the children, whether the children were interested or not. So she was taught a little bit of the veena. But I don't think she was deeply interested in it or didn't have the, I don't know what it was. She just gave it up. And then, but the veena continued to be in our house in a box. So that was the limit of her. But they were very supportive of my interest in music. And I believe when I was very young, they would play those 3-minute records of Narayan Rao Vyas and Vinayak Bua Patwardhan and Joshi Ji when I used to go to sleep. I don't know whether that has had an influence or whether it was some of the genes that I have inherited from someone. Music was something very close to, as I said, my father's heart. So he persuaded me to learn music. It was very strange. I don't know how the whole thing, leads you to one thing or another, leads you to where you eventually end up. And since my cousin was learning from Rama Rao Naik, my father asked my aunt whether she could persuade him to come home, because that was one of the necessities that we needed at that age. I was about 10 or 11 and it was not possible for me to go. And fortunately for me, he agreed to come. So he used to cycle all the way from Baswanguri to our home. And at that time, I never realized, I feel bad now, how much effort it must have taken him to cycle all over the city, going and teaching various people in their homes and cycling back from there to another place and then home. He must have been really dedicated and devoted to Vidyadhan.
It was not dissimilar in Mumbai, for example. Many of the Agra Ustads did the same
thing. Yes.
In fact, all the teachers did it at that time.
Yes. All the teachers did it.
Now, so you started with Ram Rao Naik.
Yes.
And Ram Rao Naik, of course, was a disciple of Fayaz Khan.
Ram Rao Naik ji, yes. Initially, he learned from Swami Vallabhdas. Actually, it was Swami Vallabhdas who picked him up, because when Swami Vallabhdas performed in Bangalore, Ram Rao ji accompanied him, I believe, on the harmonium. And he was so impressed, he said, "You come with me." So he went. And when Swami Vallabhdas used to go and learn from Fayaz Khan, Ram Rao ji also went. And I think most of the instruction was, to all of them, was given by Atta Hussain Khan Sahib. And the extent of Fayaz Khan Sahib's teaching was every evening or whenever Fayaz Khan Sahib sang, they would go and sit there and listen. And he would ask some of them to come and sing behind him. So it was not a one-to-one teaching process. they learned the basics and the bandishes and all from Atta Hussain Khan Saab. And then Fayaz Khan Saab maybe gave them the final polishing, how to perform, how to execute. So it must have been a very dynamic sort of a learning process.
Indeed. In fact, if you remember, once when I was visiting you in Delhi,
yes,
I had gone to interview Dilip Chandravedi.
Yes, that's right.
Who was at that time quite old and living across the Jamna. And he recounted how in the early days when he went to study with Fayaz Khan, after his first teacher, Bhaskar Bua Bakhle, passed away. And at that time, he also recounted how at the same time, Swami Vallabh Das and Ram Rav Naik were also there.
Yes, that's right.
I have notes from that interview, and this reminded me of that.
Yes.
So anyway, you started with Ram Rao Nayak at that time. And how long did you continue with him?
I continued with him till I left Bangalore in 1965. That is almost about 13, 14 years. But it was not a continuous, regular instruction. I can say 15 years, but years don't mean anything as far as I think musical teaching is concerned. It is the number of hours or the number of times you go to a teacher that matter.
Perhaps that, as well as the number of insights.
Yes.
Sometimes an hour's training is not as effective as 2 minutes insight.
Quite right. So, at that time, I was about 10 when I started with him. So, but he was a very tolerant and a very capable teacher. He knew how to handle different types of people. Ram Rao ji said that to get an idea of tabla with the classical beat, he used to play when he accompanied, when he taught me. But he said, no, you must practice on your own. So, Dattatreya Garudji would come twice a week to play the tabla with me. And he was a handicapped person. I think he had polio as a child. So, he was literally limping when he walked, and a very bad limp. But he would walk all, come by bus and walk about 3/4 of a kilometer all the way to come home. And he was the one who gave me an idea of tal. Not tal, but lai. And he was very strict as compared to Ram Rao. Suppose I missed a beat, he would say, no, do it again. Do it again, repeat it. And until I came on the right note, on the right beat, he would make me repeat. Whereas Ram Rao would say, don't worry, it will come. So I enjoyed both the freedom that Ram Rao gave and the strict discipline that Dattatreya Garudji gave. And these people, they used to come once a week, once in 2 weeks, make me sing, say, you learn this rag next time and sing it for me. And P.N. Chandavarkar ji, he was the president of the Bangalore Sangeet Sabha. So he would have one music program every month of some musician. So that was where we in Bangalore got the opportunity to hear people like Bade Ghulam Ali, Mallikarjun Mansoor, Gangubai, Bhim Sen, and even the people like so many musicians, Ghulam Mustafa Khan Saab, so many people, Sharafat Hussain Khan Saab, Jasraj Ji, they all used to come and sing. So once a month, that was, many a time they would come home. And they would say, Acha Tum Gao Sunenge. So these were all little things which kept me going.
I think at some point later, perhaps when you went away from Bangalore, you started studying with Khadim Hussain Khan Saab. Or
yes.
Can you just describe how that came about? There might have been some intermediate instructors also.
After I left, I came back from Canada. I got married and we were posted to Delhi. As my luck would have it, and my good fortune, Pandit Dinkar Kaikini was in Delhi at that time. So, and Dinkar Mam, I had known as a child, because when he had passed off, had passed from Bhatkhande College of Music in Lucknow, he used to come once a year to Bangalore, stay with P.N. Chandavarkar, and there always used to be a concert of his once a year. And he used to come home, and that was something which really kept me going. All these musicians coming home and listening to me and saying, this is this, and you can improve in this. And Ram Rao encouraged them to come, which was, I think, a very broad-minded decision on his part. And he never minded if they gave suggestions. So Dinkar Mam very kindly agreed to teach me. So in Delhi, I had the good fortune of taking Talim from Dinkar Mam, but only for a little more than a year. Because then we were transferred to Madras and then to Bombay. And once we reached Bombay, I went to Khadim Hussain Khan.
That's interesting. So the trajectory in Bangalore, you probably studied in college and then decided to go into engineering and went to Canada for some further studies.
Yes.
At that time, music was on the back seat.
Very much on the back seat.
And then you came back and somehow the back seat driver had become the front seat.
Yes. I guess these are turning points in your life. And one thing that remains with you, whether you... It keeps pulling you back. No matter where you go, it lets you go because it's sure that you're going to come back.
So then you started, when eventually you ended up in Mumbai and then started studying with Ustad Khadim Hussain Khan Saab.
Yes.
And I think from what I know, he was the principal influence after that point in your musicianship as well as your repertoire and so on. So I would like you to say a few words about him and his style of teaching and his influence on you.
My aunt, Saguna Kalyanpur, she used to learn from Khadim Hussain Khan Saab in Bombay. And whenever we had a common, her uncle and my grand uncle, he used to come to Bangalore. He always used to say, Lalit, you must learn from Khadim Hussain Khan. You must learn from Khadim Hussain Khan. So that name seemed to have registered in my brain. And once we went to Bombay, Sagun Pachi asked me to sing in their house. And when I started singing, in those days, living in Bangalore, I didn't know what Khan Saabs looked like, what they, or anything. So I started singing and somebody came. And he sat in the came right in front and he said, Gio, he encouraged me, everything. And then after the whole concert was over, Sagun Pachi introduced him as Khadim Hussain Khan Saab. Fortunately, she told me at the end, otherwise I'd have been petrified to sing. So he told me, he says, Jeete raho, tum achhi gaoge aage, chhodna mat gaane ko. Aur hamare gharane ki... And then he left. After some time, there was a knock on the door. When we opened the door, he had come back again. So he said, Tum burane manogi, main tumhe kuch kahun to. So at that time, my Hindi was zero. So I could just about understand. So he said, you sang Desi. And the combination, he sang it for me, what I did. He said, I don't think Ram Rao would have taught you like this. So think about it. When you sing, you have to realize that you are carrying forth the legacy that has been given to you by your guru. And you have to maintain that as much as possible. I was wondering whether to tell you or not, But because you belong, Ram Rao Ji belongs to my gharana, you belong to my gharana, you are like my disciple. So if I don't correct you, I will be doing you an injustice. So he told me that and he left. And that really made a very deep impression in my mind. So ever since then, I had made up my mind that if we went to Bombay ever, I would learn from him. So when we went in 69, Sagun Pachi contacted him again and said, they will come and see you. But he came home. So this was a time when the guru came to me. They say that when you need a guru, he comes to your home. So this was proof of that.
Okay. Now, so after you started studying with Khadim Hussain Khan Sahab, and I know that you worked with him for a very long time after you started with him, what was his method of teaching? How much emphasis did he put on the tradition of the gharana versus your individual development, which would allow you to develop in certain ways which were more individual to you, although the gharana training and
yes,
the style was imbibed? Can you say a few things about that?
He never taught me a rag for more than a week, 3 or 4, 5 times. That was it. Then he said, abhi tum isko aage badao.
That is and very interesting. That is extremely interesting because traditionally a lot of people, I have heard other musicians say that they were taught the same composition multiple times until they got it perfect to the point of being like a, almost like a parrot, you might say.
No, bandish, yes. Bandish, he made me repeat 30, 40, 50 times. And then he would say, abhi tum isko ghar mein jaake riyaz karo. Tumhara riyaz sunne ke liye main yahan nahi baitha hoon.
Okay, so.
Riyaz tumhe ghar mein karna padega. Main sikhane ke liye baitha hoon. So, and then after about 2 months, he would say, acha, aaj tum wo rag gao. So he would sort of check on it after a few months to see whether what he had taught had remained or whether there were some changes. And if there were, he would change them. Mm-hmm. And then there was a very common saying of his. He said, Lalita, tumhara kya hai? Aage paat aur piche sapaat. Aisa nahi hona chahiye. So, but he allowed you to develop individually. Very particular about the pronunciation of the words, where you clip them, where you end them, how you take certain phrases in certain rags. There was no grammatical explanation. Ah. He would say, ye komal rishab aur thoda niche aana chahiye. Isko is andaaz se dekho. इसको तुम ऊपर से ले रही हो थोड़े धीरे धीमी गति से ले लो. That was all. It was either lower or higher or faster or slower. But until I got that shade of frequency right, we would stick there.
So basically, you could summarize it by saying the sur ka lagao was the most.
Yes.
The most.
Sur ka lagao. Yes.
That was, and, that was the focus of his
focus. And also the first time he taught her, he did not give me the aro, avro, vadi, samvadi. Those were all not given at all. He would just give a chalan. And he said, tum is chalan ko tum achhi tarah apnaogi to pura raag khul jayega.
I see. Yeah. The grammar was unimportant, but the movement, yes, was very important.
Yeah, and also how you took certain phrases, what emphasis you give, what kanaswars you use. But they were not called kanaswars. Mm. I mean, according to his vocabulary, he said, tum is tarah le lo. He would demonstrate. It was more, yes, an oral instruction. Agra, as you know, Ramesh Ma'am very well, has a very large repertoire. And I was always fascinated by the number of rags that the gharana has. He did teach me some of the rare compositions and the rags of his gharana, for which I'm very grateful. But he was very particular. He said, no recording when I teach. And I would, when I went to him, I tried to write the notation. Not that I was very good at notation, but it was Dinkar Mam who introduced me into notating and also analyzing rags, for which I'm very, very grateful, because that was an aspect which neither Ram Rao nor Khan Saab emphasized. And it was because of Dinkar Mam's influence that even today, that helped, and later I met Gindeji and all of them. So that gave me an input as to why these analyzing certain aspects of rags is important for one's own satisfaction and conviction. So so many rags he taught me, and the sad part is because I didn't notate them, some of them I've forgotten. But he said, if you write it down, tumhare man mein kabhi nahi baithega. Kyunki tumhare man ke piche ye rahega ki kitab mein hai, jabhi chahiye main dekh lu. And I felt somehow at that time that I had to be totally loyal and true to what he said. Otherwise, that guru shishya, that relationship might go astray. I could have gone home and written down the notations, but I did not. Because he didn't want me to. What to mention was that I did get a chance to perform in music circles. I performed in P.N. Chandavakar's house, a full concert, and then in Bangalore Sangeet Sabha, in Madras, in Dharwad, and small little places like that. And also won the first prize in the Sur Singar Samsad competition in Bombay. For under 30, and I was about 15 or, and I got to sing in the Swami Haridas Sammelan, which was for me something very great, because at that time, Kesarbhai and Panalal Ghosh and all of Rahimuddin Dagar, all of them were singing. And so I was right in the beginning on the day when Kesarbhai was last. So I got a chance to hear Kesarbhai also. So these were, you know, as you say, encouragements which kept me going.
There were big moments for anyone. And you were just 15 at the time. That's fantastic. Yeah.
And as I was saying, the musicians used to come home, and Jasraj ji and Onkarnath Thakur told my father, she is made for music. Don't let her study. You send her to us. We will make her a musician. And my father was very firm. He said, no, music is just a hobby. She has to study first. And later, almost 30 years later, when I met Jasraj ji again in Bombay, he remembered and he said, "Maine tumhare pitaji se kaha tha ki tumhara gaane mein hi tumhari ye hai." Aur unhone suna nahi, na tumne suna, abhi dekho, magar kitne saal kho gaye beech mein. So it's just turning points in your life that bring you back. No matter where you stray, you come back. The only subjects that I could think of in were mathematics and physics. So when I I wanted to do engineering, but in those days in Karnataka, women were not allowed into the government engineering colleges. So I had to do my BSc in Maharani's College and then join the Indian Institute of Science for a 3-year postgraduate degree in, it was called ECE. So I did communication engineering there. And then of course it was not so rare. It was rare. Like there were 3 of us women in my class, then 2 in the class above us and 4 in the class above. So there were 1, 2, 3, 4 like that, but it was still a big minority. And then when I went to Canada to do my master's, I was the only woman in the engineering department there. Except in the undergraduate, there was one girl. Otherwise, I was the only one. But it never, they were all very good to me. They never made me feel, separate or anything. It was...
Of course, you have performed extensively. You have been recognized for your performing in many awards, and I won't go into that. Those are, I think your satisfaction is derived mainly from the way you evaluate yourself, not when others
yes. evaluate you. That's right.
What I'm interested is in the fact that you have also groomed some very excellent singers. So I want to focus on a little bit about your teaching and also about a couple of views which have been expressed by various musicologists over the last several years, which talk about the Agra tradition as being male-oriented and so on, which I personally do not agree with it at all. I don't think any tradition is actually oriented towards any gender. But it is true that after the initial few women singers in the Agra Gharana, there was a period for a long time where very few women singers, in fact, prospered in it. And you're one of them who did, and also have actually trained some excellent students. So I want to hear a little bit about your method of teaching.
It's very strange. When I performed, I never thought of teaching. And I thought teaching would be very boring. And I just didn't want to think about it. And I think there comes a time when I had problems with my voice, when I lost my voice, I couldn't perform the way I should. I think in all this, one needs to be appraise yourself truly. It's not that I don't have a voice now. It's not that I can't perform. But I feel I cannot perform the way I should. And so I stopped performing in public. And I said, Khan Saab has, and Dinkar Ma'am and Ram Rao have given me such a wealth of knowledge. Why not I teach and pass on the Vidya that they have given me? And in this, I was strongly encouraged by Jaivan. He has always been a staunch pillar of support for whatever I've done. And I can never be grateful enough for him, to him for what he has done for me. You always need somebody who pushes you forward. And he has been the main force. And he said, okay, you can't sing. What difference does it make? You can still sing and live in your music when you teach. So that is how when we moved to Bangalore, I started teaching. And God up there seems to have been very kind to me, because he blessed me with some very talented students. Talented, very devoted, dedicated, and very open. I teach the way Ram Rao Ji and Khan Saab taught me instinctively.
I remember once you sang Khem Kalyan.
Yes.
This was after you stopped performing extensively.
Yes.
But the phrasing was so beautiful that I still remember it after so many years. So some of it, see, I'm reminded of an anecdote about Begum Akhtar. He was singing at one concert, there was an intermission, and she used to smoke. So she went out, and she was smoking. So somebody went and told her, Begum Sahiba, aap abhi cigarette pee rahi hain, lekin aapko gale ko asar nahi hoga. So she said, apparently, are gana gale se thoda gaya jata hai. So the phrasing and the way in which you cast the voice is part of the artistry. And in fact, when I hear some recordings of Khadim Hussain Khan Saab or Latafat Hussain Khan Saab and so on, I'm reminded of this because sometimes, in especially the old in their older age, the recordings were not so beautiful in tone.
Yes.
But the artistry of the throw of the voice and
yes.
way in which the taal was maintained, that was the artistry behind the whole thing. And that was really, really very difficult.
I still feel that I'm learning because as I teach, as I think about the music, as I think about what to teach them and what to tell them, it is a very big learning experience for me. So that is why I'm still in music and I don't feel bad or sad at all. I'm quite very happy with the way things have worked out. Because if I was performing, I don't think I would have understood music so much. I would have just performed.
Yeah, well, of course, the ocean of music, you know, it's
yes.
vast. I'm reminded of the Sanskrit couplet on which there is also an Agra Bandish in Bheem Palas, actually. It says, Nadab Destu Paramparam Najanati Saraswati.
Yes.
Adhyapi Majjana Bhayat Tumbam Vahati Vakshasi.
Nada Samudra Kohe Mahakatinara.
Exactly, exactly. That one, you see. So.
So. Okay. I still remember my visit to Seattle and the Ragmala that you used to run. Jayavant and I were just talking last night, the amount of work that all of you did, carrying the mics, carrying the loudspeakers, ferrying us, making the tea, carrying that, taking it there, setting it up, putting up the chairs. I can never forget all that. Yeah. And then getting us to sing, then packing up everything, bringing all the rugs and the carpets and the loudspeakers and all the equipment home. And you know, when I came back, I said, why would anyone do all that? Then I realized the spell music has cast over us.
Well,
and
people,
you know, those memories that are unforgotten because we came, we stayed with you, you arranged the whole thing, you took us there, you brought us back. And the amount of effort that you, Shantaka, and your whole group, not only you both, but everyone, it's incredible. And those memories are unforgettable. So I'm so glad that Ragmala has started again because it has a great past. And I'm sure it will have a very great future too.
Thank you.
Thank you.